week, was this week or last week? It might have been last week. We visited a school in Toronto that had a horticultural and landscaping program. It was part of the specialist high skills major program. And so when I was at Parkdale Collegiate Institute, I spoke to the students about their experience. And of course, they loved the greenhouse. I mean, who wouldn't? The air is fresher in the greenhouse, the sun is brighter. It's a great place. But one of the students, her name is Huda, she said to me, "I love this program because what I'm learning here will get me a job." She understood the connection between what she was learning and her potential beyond school. So our students have that appreciation. In fact, I believe our students have that expectation that what they're learning is going to be relevant. Experiential learning is one of these crucial and critical opportunities that we need to provide to students for the next chapter in their lives, so that it keeps up with a changing world. The pace of that world is changing rapidly. It's full of challenges, but it's also full of opportunities. And we have to help students to see those opportunities, to make those connections. And we know that a high quality education system can also protect our students in the face of that constant change and provide them with a lifetime of greater security and greater options, no matter what the world brings. So there must be a greater emphasis on useful and practical learning. And that is why we are modernizing the curriculum so that students will gain transferable skills that include things like critical thinking, communications, collaboration, creativity, entrepreneurship and innovation. And what about learning to think and learn? What about just the skill of knowing what is a fact and what is not? Right? Because for some of us that, you know, I entered university when it was the Mac computers came in, and we were just sort of learning about it then, right? But our students, that's not what they see, right? They are born in a digital world. So how do they discern what is real and what is not? That has to be part of 21st century learning. These are the skills that students will need to become successful, to be productive, compassionate, and actively engaged as global citizens. So I want you to know that the fundamentals, just so I don't get that question later, the fundamentals of reading, writing, mathematics, in fact, where is that gentleman? He asked me the mathematics question while I was walking in the door. Where are you? Numeracy, right? The math, we are focused on that. In fact, it's one of the leading portions of our curriculum refresh. So students are prepared to seize those opportunities that lie ahead. So we know that it's important to refresh the curriculum. We know that it's important to link that to what students need to learn. And together, with the help of students and educators and parents and our stakeholders, and with the support, and I want to say thank you for People for Education for stepping up and being part of the change and participating in our Transformation Steering Committee, we will look to refresh Ontario's curriculum over the next 3 to 5 years. And this curriculum refresh will be done with an intentional focus on embedding equity, well-being into how students learn, and the kind of learning that provides students with the tools to connect what they learn inside the classroom with the real world. These experiential learning opportunities, such as field trips, field studies, job shadowing, co-op education, provide authentic opportunities for students to have deeper understanding of the curriculum. And it can lead them to explore and develop their interests, their talents, and their aspirations. These hands-on learning opportunities really allow students to better understand their strengths and to build essential and transferable skills. It really puts them at the center of learning. These are the opportunities also that support students in forging new connections between their studies as well as their future career pathways. So you may have heard about our recent announcement to assist schools in developing and exploring more opportunities for all students. I'm very excited about this. By having every school board across the province hire an experiential learning coordinator to better connect our schools with the communities around them, to provide leadership to support the expansion of experiential learning at all grade levels, from kindergarten through to grade 12 and to adult learners, frankly. Boards and school authorities will receive this funding to build teachers' capacity to plan and to implement effective experiential learning opportunities. And I believe that this funding will support greater involvement of the community members and develop partnerships within local communities and their schools that lead to a new and unique learning opportunity for all students. So, earlier this year, we launched a series of 29 career studies pilot projects to explore new ways of learning and teaching within the current careers course. And I have to say, one of the aspects in Ontario's education system that we could do more of is relying on our own teachers and educators in their professional judgment as we develop these resources and these tools. And that's exactly what we did in these 29 career studies pilot projects. We looked to our teachers and we said, how do we improve this and make it better? And the results of the pilots have been very successful. So we're expanding the career studies projects starting next September. And I'm also pleased to say that financial literacy will now be a mandatory part of the grade 10 career studies course and part of Ontario's curriculum. We'll also include digital literacy, innovation, as well as entrepreneurship and creativity and pathways planning for students. This will be a mandatory component and it will enhance our capacities in this area where we're already doing well, but we can do better. We need to give parents better information about their child's progress. And we're also looking at updating our provincial assessment and reporting practices, including report cards as well as EQAO. So over the next 6 months, a review of assessment is being planned and led by Dr. Carol Campbell, as well as the Premier and my education advisors, of which Dr. Jean Clinton is among them. Consultations on this are already happening across the province. They're starting this month to make sure that the assessments are relevant to the system of education that we have today, whether it's culturally relevant or relevant in other assessment ways, and to support a wide range of learning opportunities. That is something that we've heard repeatedly that needs to be enhanced in our assessment practices to better reflect student well-being, equity, as well as achievement across all school environments. I'm looking at Annie. I'm looking at you just to get a sense of the time. Okay, I'm almost done. So my role as Minister of Education, and I take this role very seriously, is to make sure that all students succeed, that all students have an opportunity to succeed, no matter where they live, and no matter what their backgrounds or needs. And you know, when I visit schools, wherever they are, and I visited our schools, our Section 23 schools, in hospital settings. I visited our Section 68 schools in facilities where students are there for whatever reason. What I see is that education is an incredible pathway for students. Justice Murray Sinclair, he says that education heals, that it actually has that ability when we talk about our truth and reconciliation and the journey that we're on. And so, as I mentioned earlier, an intentional focus of the transformation that we're making to Ontario's education system is on well-being and equity. And let me be clear, we are dedicated to removing barriers to success and well-being for all students. All students. And that's why we have developed the Education Equity Action Plan, with its focus on removing discriminatory biases and practices from teaching and from learning experiences, and that we are introducing a renewed approach to grade 9 so that students are better able to explore their pathways. Grade 9 should be that moment where they believe that they can do it, where expectations are high for all students, and where they can have an insight into their future and how education plays a role in that, whether it's to work or to go to college or university or an apprenticeship program. Every young person should believe that they are capable of achieving. So we are embarking on this ambitious plan, and it requires that we work together. It requires that we collaborate together, just as your focused session today, making those connections with all partners and with all stakeholders, so that our system of education becomes one in which all students in Ontario have an opportunity to achieve their fullest potential. So I want to thank People for Education for always being there, holding our feet to the fire, and making improvements to Ontario's education system, and to all of you for taking the time. I've seen many of you in many different contexts, and I know how passionate you are about education, publicly funded education. So I want to say thank you, merci, and miigwech.